Good morning, Justice Monga. A very warm welcome to this webinar on gender sensitization. I have great pleasure in introducing Honorable Mr. Justice Arun Monga. Justice Monga is a blend of a lawyer and a judge. First generation lawyer and second generation judge. Justice Monga's father retired from Punjab Superior Judicial Service. Justice Monga, after having graduated with science from DAV College, Chandigarh, joined the Punjab University for his law studies. While studying law, Justice Monga taught chemistry. And therefore, Justice Monga knows the chemistry of law so very well. Justice Monga joined the Bar of Punjab and Haryana High Court in the year 1991. After the initial years, in the year 1997-98, Justice Monga shifted over to Delhi. And for the next 20 years, he was a litigating lawyer and also an advisor in the corporate sector. His main canvas was the courtroom and the boardrooms. And in that particular process, 20 years, he enjoyed every bit of that. In October 2018, Justice Monga was elevated as judge of Punjab and Haryana High Court. And now he is enjoying his judicial innings that he is playing so effectively. Our constitution is an all-season document. Today, Justice Monga would be dealing with gender sensitization from the constitutional prism. The format of this particular webinar would be, after the address of Justice Monga, the questions in the chat box would be moderated by a faculty member, come additional district judge, Madam Harshali Chaudhary. She's a keen moderator. And therefore, after the address, every aspect would be monitored by Harshali Chaudhary. May I present to you Justice Arun Monga. Start the session. I'm so sorry for the
moment. No, it's all right. It's all right. I must say, on a lighter note, I think my introduction which you made was so overloaded that the software crashed. It couldn't bear with such an overloaded introduction. My introduction would have been very simple, Dr. Balarama Gupta sir, I'm your student, that's all, one line. And it's an honor to be addressing issues with constitutional perspective, given that I have been a student of yours and you taught us constitutional law. So it's really, you know, I remember when as a lawyer I used to appear as a young lawyer. I practiced initially in Chandigarh, followed by Delhi. And I must compliment, I saw a stark difference between the judicial officers in Punjab, Haryana, including Chandigarh and Delhi. I found the judicial officer in our states so polite, so considerate to the young lawyers, whereas, to be honest, judicial officers in Delhi, it's quite an experience. Sometimes it's very intimidating to appear before them. In fact, I used to be more at unease appearing before judicial officers in Delhi rather than High Court or Supreme Court. Strangely, I don't know. Looking at my own self, it seems like a monologue going on. It should have been so much more interesting had I been there in person, seeing you all. While I can't see any of you, but I see myself on the screen. Anyway, coming back to the issue in hand today, gender sensitization. I'm glad in some ways that it's a blessing in disguise I'm speaking after Madam Kiran. She has covered most of the topics, so it will be less boring for you now. Otherwise, I would have had also covered the same, and perhaps she would have ended up repeating all of that. Gender sensitization, what is it really? Fundamentally, it is a behavior, in behavior of a human being in such a manner that one is sensitive towards each gender, not necessarily women, men as well, and now, as we all know, third gender is transgender. In fact, the general term for this is now LGBT, lesbian, gay, bisexuals, and transgender. So general behavior, we all learn as we grow up based on our social surroundings, based on the expectations of men and women around us. So it is that sensitization which is termed as gender sensitization. It has really speaking nothing to do with sexuality, which is purely a biological factor. Gender is purely, I would say, a bit different from sexuality per se. It is socio and cultural phenomena in a human being to sensitize us towards each gender. But since from times, ancient times, men have been the privileged, the dominant part of society. Therefore, somehow sensitization is speaking of the male dominance. It's is in general parlance perceived as being sensitive towards the, if I can use the word, weaker section, which it is not. Biologically, it is not. It is us, the society, which has been addressing it as weaker section. So therefore, it is invariably taken as being sensitive towards women when we call it gender sensitization. And that is why our framers of constitution have made special provisions for women in the constitution, while there are no such provisions for men folk. It's only for women. And there's a reason. Let's even look at our own religious scriptures. It's rather sad but true. In Ramayana, which is written by great Tulsidas, I mean, like, it's really unthinkable that one would write such a thing, but it is true. It's written in Ramayana. It says dhol, gamvar, shudra, pashu, and then comes the word nari. Dhol, gamvar, shudra, pashu, nari, ye sab taadan ke adhikari. Now, this is what led to the decay in, if I can call it perhaps, bit of decay in society in looking at the other, I mean, when I say other, by men folk, looking at the other gender in such terms. And in fact, later on followed by Manu Smriti, which is the oldest Hindu legal code book. Even there also, woman has been given a rather similar treatment as great Tulsidas. This is what led to the framing of provisions in the constitution. Constitution of India is not to be confused per se or to be perceived as if it's a feminist document. It is certainly not feminist, but it does incorporate certain, if one can call it as, certain feminist provisions, which Madam Kiran has already run you through, like Article 15, Article 16, Special Provisions 23, then Fundamental Duties. But most importantly, before one runs inside to the Constitution, even the preamble starts with the word justice, liberty, equality and fraternity. So justice has to be, what is it really? Justice has to be social. That's where comes this gender sensitization part. You cannot have justice without being sensitive towards gender. Then liberty has to be of thought. So there has to be in your thoughts similar gender sensitization. Then equality has to be that of the status. So when it comes to the status, again, unless we have that sensitive outlooks towards gender, you cannot possibly provide similar status to all gender. It has to be equality of status. And then all of this collectively, liberty, justice, and equality, this has to be blended into a fraternity. This all has to be integral part of our fraternity, so that each one's dignity, every individual's dignity, is assured in the fraternity. That is where the entire genesis, one must look at it from that perspective, genesis of the gender sensitization. So it was in this context, in fact, Dr. Ambedkar, during the Constituent Assembly debates, he also mentioned it, that this is the very basic principle which the equality, the liberty, the social justice and fraternity, they cannot be divorced from each other. There cannot be any liberty without equality, and likewise there cannot be any equality without any liberty. So now, as I already said, that I don't want to take you to really the basic constitutional provisions, but also given that in trial courts one doesn't really get to deal with constitutional matters as much, but given the duties of the judicial officers, the courts below, judicial courts at the grassroots level, in fact, they are the real custodians of constitutional provisions. One must always be mindful. There may not be petitions per se filed under these provisions, but definitely they are equally applicable in non-writ jurisdiction as much as in writ jurisdiction, which we handle every day under 2 to 6. Now, Article 14, the very basic equality before law. Now, equality means equality of all genders, obviously. From the today's perspective, from the today's point of view, gender sensitization. And Article 15, it says, again, it's a gender sensitive outlook, no discrimination on the grounds of sex. Then 15.3, again, it provides for special provisions of women and children. Now, that special provision is, again, from a gender sensitive point of view, that they do need such protections. Given the, I just told you, given the background, the mindsets starting from Great Tulsidas onwards. Then Article 16, again, non-discrimination on the grounds of sex. You cannot have a male-dominated work environment. It has to be definitely non-gender-based. Each one is, in fact, of late there are judgments now. In fact, there's a statute now, Transgender Protection Act, by virtue of which now soon we'll have the third gender being equally given same kind of preferences as others in matters of employment. We'll soon have police officers, lawyers, apart from only just litigants, even fellow colleagues, judicial officers. So in that sense, it becomes all the more imperative that we have a gender sensitive outlook, taking a departure from just man and woman. It has to be now all genders, as I said, LGBT. So apart from the fundamental rights, then comes the fundamental duties, various articles 39A, D, E, then Article 42, which says state shall make provisions for securing just and human conditions of work and for maternity relief. So what I'm trying to just bring forth is that we are constitutionally conscious of having a gender sensitive outlook. Such is the importance of gender sensitization. You know, the constitution has made provisions. So it is in this perspective. It is not to provide any kind of preferential treatment to women. It is only to ensure that we have a gender sensitive outlook. And it is in this context that even in the matters of now franchise, in the matters of elections, if we look at Article 243, it provides that 1/3 of total number of seats by way of direct election in every panchayat has to be reserved for women. Similar is the position in 243T, which says every municipality will have 1/3 as councillors. So moving on from now constitution to our various high courts and Supreme Court, historically they have addressed all these issues of gender sensitization as envisaged in 14, 15, 16 articles through judgments from time to time. In fact, they have expounded the gender sensitive outlook by taking it out not only from 14, 16, they have expanded it to, they means the various courts, including of course the torchbearer of us all Supreme Court. They have expounded it to Article 21 by including it, right to dignity, right to privacy. These are all gender sensitive outlooks which have been incorporated through these rights. Then right to choose your partner, again a woman has as much as a man. Then comes the basic fundamental freedoms, and it's under Article 19. Now all this is also supported by India being signatory to the international conventions on civil rights, and there's a covenant on civil and political rights 1966, then followed by convention on elimination of discrimination against women, which is in 1979. In fact, the letter is also called as Bill of Rights, this convention of elimination of discrimination against women. This is also called Bill of Rights, which led to a very important judgment by Supreme Court, which is, we all know now, Geeta Hariharan versus Reserve Bank of India. In this case, this was the first case where a mother had challenged the natural guardianship of a father merely on the ground of the statutory provision which was read down. It said that during the lifetime of a father, he is the natural guardian, and it is only subsequently that mother becomes the natural guardian of a child. Now, Supreme Court read it down. It held that no, a mother of a minor child is to be regarded as a natural guardian on equal footing, even during the lifetime of father. Now, this is called gender equality in real sense, but arises out of having a gender sensitive outlook. Now, talking of that, it was in this context that Vishakha came. Vishakha is now, of course, formally adopted into a statute. But before the statute came, protection of harassment of women at workplace, the statute is called. So before the statute came, Supreme Court had held, they have the powers under 142 to declare judgment as a law until formal law comes. So they declared that it is the responsibility of legislature and executive government equally to ensure that working women could live with dignity and in a safe environment. Now, such is the imperativeness of all of us to have the gender sensitive outlook. Now, invariably, we do somehow tend to misunderstand that the protection, the constitutional protection for women, the protection which various judgments have provided to the women, that arises out of course, gender sensitive outlook, but we should look at it from a broader perspective. It is not really protection. It is empowerment. It is only when we empower the other gender that we are truly gender sensitive. Providing protection is not a solution, really. It is the empowerment of a woman. More we empower them, more confident they become, lesser will be our own requirement, possibly in that sense, to be gender sensitive any further. That's when the real equality will happen amongst all genders. So it is the that traditional outlook of understanding the gender sensitivity to mean as if providing protection is the solution. No, that's not really that's a very narrow and restrictive understanding of being gender sensitive. The broader is that there should be empowerment. The broader is in the real sense, we have to change our outlook to consider women as a weaker sex. They are not. It is our patriarchal practice somehow, which under the guise of the patriarchal outlook, under the guise of which we try to provide them protection, thinking as if we are superior, we are more dominant, so therefore they need protection. It is not. In fact, strangely, if you speak of the nature is perhaps the biology, the nature has made women the most powerful. Women, they have the power to give birth. Can there be something more powerful than that? They are most empowered in real sense. It is the man somehow who has tried to, under the guise this patriarchal outlook, try to make the woman feel that though they are less powerful and therefore they need protection, etc. Now, talking of providing protection, so the outlook, narrow outlook of providing protection sometimes leads to discrimination. Now, illustratively, in Punjab, there was this act called Punjab Excise Act 2014. Now, the nobility of it was that it said that it is for the protection of women that we're making this provision. Now, the provision under the act was that it prohibited employment of women in bars and similar like establishments where alcohol is served. But the ostensible reason was that this provision is in their own interest and for their own protection. Well, Supreme Court then eventually dealt with this issue in Anuj Garg versus Hotel Association of India, and it set aside such a protection. It said, sorry, this is not how you should look at. This is not really the import of being gender sensitive. This is not how you should look at it. Protection is not the solution. Empowerment is the solution. So if I can quote Supreme Court here, it said, instead of prohibiting women's employment in bars altogether, the state should focus on factoring in ways through which unequal consequences of sex differences can be eliminated. It is state's duty to ensure circumstances of safety which inspire confidence in women to discharge the duty freely in accordance to the requirements of the profession they choose to follow. So, hard-hitting words. What does it really essentially mean? Twofold. One, it said it is duty of the state to provide protection, so do not take away their right to choose the profession under the garb of protecting them. Empower them. They must have equal right to choose the profession. If you think it is unsafe for them, then make arrangements in your own administrative setup. It is the duty of the state that they should feel safe coming back late in the night after doing those jobs, or within the restaurant when they're serving alcohol, they feel protected, they feel safe. Then court also went on to say in the same very judgment, Anush Garg that instead of putting curbs on women's freedom, empowerment would be more tenable and socially wise approach. Truly so. Truly so. That's exactly what I was saying, that it's a very patriarchal and very narrow outlook to look at laws or to interpret laws to mean that women are a weaker section of in any sense, and or therefore they need any special protection. What they need is empowerment. Now, when we talk of gender sensitive outlook, I started with the Constitution Article 14, which says everyone has to be treated equal. The idea being that equality lifts everyone, all genders. The moment you treat all genders equally, the mandate of 14 is automatically met. So, but at the same time, gender equality cannot be possibly seen or measured by just seeing the other gender, if I can say. I'm saying the other gender in the perspective of constitutional provisions specially framed for women. So we should not see it as or measure it as women holding up positions of power. Like if a woman is a president of a country or a prime minister or a chief justice, that would not per se mean that equality has come now in the sense that, but you have to look at it from social point of view, not only just few seats being, if we were to really apply this as any measurement of social equality or gender equality, then perhaps during the colonial days we were best suited for so long we were governed by British, which was ruled by Queen. But yet, women were definitely not equal. They were definitely not emancipated. Not at all. So, and also it is not to be misunderstood that it is only a woman leader who can usher in empowerment of the other women. India for long has been, you know, we had woman leader as prime minister. So gender equality is, in real sense, to me, is how ordinary women are treated every day. That's where gender equality is to be measured. As members in our family, in community, at workplaces, whether they have equal opportunities to participate and contribute in the society, that is the real measure of gender equality. Treating women as equal while acknowledging and respecting differences on account of gender, that is the real meaning of gender equality. Equality in matters of employment. In fact, that is where the gender sensitive outlook has to be to begin with. That is where the real empowerment, that is where the real evolution of being gender sensitive begins. In fact, not many of us will be aware that today we have in foreign service women, as well as in the not only foreign service, in the foreign offices, a lot of women working. But until 1979, service conditions for foreign service personnel, they required for female employees, they had to obtain a permission before getting married, merely because you are a female and you're working in a foreign service office, and that provision didn't exist for males. And likewise, a married woman was denied the right to be employed in a foreign office. So it was the first time in 79 that Supreme Court struck it down in C.B. Muthama's case. I think this is a gender insensitive outlook. This is discriminatory for sure. And then I just, you forget 79, as late as Anuj Garg, which is only, I think, 2018, this provision was struck down. So this is this this shows that we are still evolving in our gender sensitive approach. We still not very gender sensitive. So in fact, coming to, yes, I was myself a counselor. When I was a lawyer, it all began over a dinner discussion at home with my father. My sister, who is incidentally an Indian Air Force officer, she's currently group captain. She was recruited in Air Force. At that time, they had just about opened Air Force, but though they made it a very laudable thing that India for the first time is recruiting female Air Force officers, but not many of us would know. While on one hand they tried to make it look gender equal, but at the same time there was a severe gender discrimination within that. While they opened it for female officers, but they put a rider that female officers will be only for a short service commission, whereas male officers had the choice to be permanent commission, which means that you can, until you retire, you continue in Air Force, while female officers were given only 5 years short service commission. So my sister, of course, joined it when the short service commission came to end. They extended it one more time. And now after 10 years of service, your employability is zero outside once you come out, because you've gone past the employment age in government offices and your middle age, so you neither here nor there. At the same time, they said, sorry, this was the service condition, short service commission, your term is over, you go. So I filed a writ petition, being conscious that it is my sister's case, so I didn't want her name to be the first name. So I chose one of her colleagues, Monica Bijlani and others. So this was the entire batch of my sister in Air Force. So I filed a case for them. It was in Delhi High Court, fought it. And of course, her case didn't get as much reported as an earlier case, which Madam Kiran just referred it in, while telling you, that Babita Punia. She was an armed force officer, similarly situated. They were also told after short service to leave. So hers was a priorly in time. So it became Union of Babita Punia versus Union of India and others. So my petition was Air Force petition, Babita Punia was Armed Forces. So while allowing both Delhi High Court, in fact, Justice Kaul was in fact heading the DB at that time, as he then was in Delhi High Court, now of course Supreme Court judge. He began the judgment very beautifully. He struck down, he said it is discriminatory, you cannot do this. This is being gender insensitive, gender discriminatory. You cannot do this. You allow this for men officers to have permanent commission, but women at the peak of their middle age, 35, 40, you leave them high and dry. You cannot do that. So all the Air Force officers and Army officers are equally entitled to permanent commission. Now, when it came to Air Force, I was the counsel there. Somehow, for whatever reasons, better sense prevailed in the Air Force. They did not challenge it in Supreme Court. So my sister, ever since now, she got permanent commission now. That time she would have retired as perhaps, not retired, it's not even retirement at 10 years, she would have been just a pilot officer, but now she's a group captain serving. They did not challenge it in Supreme Court. But Army was challenged in Supreme Court. As a result, Army girls, officers, they didn't get permanent commission until Supreme Court decided 3-4 years later, whereas Air Force implemented it much earlier. So coming back to Justice Kaul, in fact, he started the judgment beautifully. His opening line in the judgment, the Air Force case was, he said, I quote him here, "Nature gave too much power to women, but man gave none." What a beautiful quote to begin with. This is the kind of gender sensitive outlook one must have. Speaking of courts from time to time having gender sensitive outlook, the last of it one can perhaps see the Sabarmati. Well, the judgment is under review though, but by majority of 4-1 in this Indian Young Association, Lawyers Association versus State of Kerala, in normal parlance we know it as Sabarimala temple entry case, where women sheer on the sheer ground of being women, the gender women, female sex, they were denied the right to enter the Sabarimala temple to worship Lord Ayyappa by a majority of 4-1. It was held that this customary practice, there is no law, it was just a custom, this customary practice of barring entry of women merely on the ground of them being, if one can call it, not being impure. Now, what was the impurity? The menstruating age group people, we female, were not allowed to enter because Lord Ayyappa felt that menstruating woman is not so pure. So, whereas, what is the logic in this? Nobody knows. And in fact, Justice Nariman observed, he said, menstruation is not pure by any means. So, how can that be the ground of denial? Just being very, very insensitive to women. So, court intervened, set aside this customary practice. They said, no, you provide them protection. If they want to go to temple, they will go. It's a freedom. It's their freedom envisaged under the fundamental rights, freedom of Article 25. So they have to be allowed. So being mindful of gender sensitization, it is in this context that we have a lot of gender just laws. So people would like to perhaps argue in reverse that if they are so empowered, if they are so equal, why provide them protections through statutes? They do require, because of, as I said, our social outlook, our gender insensitive outlook from centuries. Therefore, the legislature, being conscious, has made certain gender protection, gender just laws. So examples of those are protection of women from domestic violence, 2005 Act, then prevention of sexual harassment at workplace, Vishakha judgment led to it, 2013 it was enacted. So it is while interpreting the provisions of such gender protection laws that one has to look at the statement of objects and reasons of those acts, that we understand that why those statutes are required. The essential reason is, of course, the gender insensitiveness in our society, that we need such laws. So, but that would be the social cause. But the otherwise, the meaning, the real intent of that law is to provide them empowerment by way of these statutory protections. You've already been briefed on the Supreme Court's judgment on NALSA versus Union of India, where Supreme Court for the first time said that we have to go beyond man and woman when we come to gender sensitive outlook. It doesn't just mean man and woman. It has been held now by Supreme Court also in the judgments that there's a third gender, transgender. They also need equally sensitive outlook. We have to be equally sensitive towards them. And NALSA was followed by Navtej Johar, where right to choose a partner of any sexual orientation was held to be totally valid. So, in fact, that has also led to a statute now for transgender persons protection of rights act 2019. Now, that essentially recognizes the transgender persons and persons who change their gender by choice from male to female or female to male. So now this legislature has also formally come up with the statute, given the importance of every gender being equal, including the transgenders. And in fact, some states have now come up, they've opened up recruitments in their police forces and other offices for transgenders. Tamil Nadu has done it, Odisha has done it, Chhattisgarh has done it. So So it's time that soon we will perhaps be heading towards judicial services, judicial officers. So unless we have a gender sensitive outlook towards all gender, definitely it's going to be a self-inflicting injury. We have to have this approach now, gender sensitive. So as judicial officers, we'll have to now not only engage with LGBT litigants, we'll be dealing with lawyers who are from LGBT police forces, including court staff. And of course, as I said, changing times, fellow colleagues as well. So the real import of gender sensitization lies when we treat them with equality, when we treat them with respect and dignity in our immediate environment. That's where it really begins. That's what gender sensitization means. Now, she just quoted Shakespeare to you. What's in a name? Rose by any other name will still smell as sweet. So exactly, what is in a name? But sometimes, well, we have to be conscious that it's not misunderstood what's in the name. No, there are certain words and expressions which can be very stigmatizing, very insensitive, and worsens the sense of wrong that litigation has already been inflicted with. Now, if as judges we are not conscious, we are not sensitive by using more respectful expressions, we may not be found in law. But we have to be, like, for example, Supreme Court in this statute called Immoral Traffic Prevention Act 1956, which uses the term prostitute. Now, statute uses the word prostitute. So one would say, oh, so what's wrong with it? So what's wrong with it? Well, just stretching the example from what's in the name. So call it by any name, prostitute would still be. But Supreme Court said, no, we have to be gender sensitive. We cannot stigmatize, or we cannot make the insensitive worse than it already is. So it was the word coined sex worker in the judgment, the Buddha Dev Karmaskar versus State of West Bengal. So the word, instead of prostitute, was substituted sex work in the court proceedings. So that's where now, today, everyone now knows the word sex worker, but in the statute, it's prostitute. So in fact, Madam X has now come to stay. In fact, most proceedings now, we try to hide the name. Supreme Court ruled First, it was Supreme Court, of course, which ruled that judgments dealing with sexual exploitation of a woman, we must protect their identity. They should not be named in the judgment, so that the woman remains protected from any social stigma with regard to the fact that the accused name may be there. It doesn't matter, because he, in the end, if he's convicted, he deserves. He deserves no such sensitiveness. But yes, what if he's acquitted? We may have to have a different outlook. He as it being gender sensitization does not really, as I said, mean towards women. If a man is not guilty, but by the time you have really made his pain much worse by naming him everywhere. In fact, in one of my own judgments, I have brought out this issue that yes, as far as possible, unless someone is really convicted, we should try to protect the identities of both genders. One doesn't know who's right, who's wrong, and when the trial is going on. In fact, taking it a little in the same context, what is in the name? It sometimes, well, there is a stigma sometimes in the name. Now, in one of my judgments I was dealing with on the service law, I found that in Haryana, perhaps in Punjab also, they still use the colonial word mistress for a teacher in a school. So it was a recruitment case, so and so number of posts of mistresses advertised. So I found that this is a very gender insensitive way of calling a teacher a mistress. So I give a judgment, and I'm glad that it wasn't challenged, that they are in the process of implementing, they made some amendments, and instead of the word mistress, now it has been substituted with teacher, I believe, for primary school teachers in Punjab. And I'm not sure about Punjab, but since that was the case of Haryana, perhaps Haryana has done it. Now, all these other challenges which the courtroom faces every day, she has already enumerated from the judgment, that where a lady was asked to tie rakhi, Supreme Court has given parameters that while doing cross-examination or examination of a woman witness, we should be careful that the court does it itself, and one has to show sensitivity while recording testimonies of prosecutrices and POXO and sexual offences cases and so on and so forth. So these are the challenges I'm sure you're conscious of as judicial officers. In Aparna part, they laid out a whole heap of parameters which already been read out to you, Madam Kiran. I just was hearing her while she was saying. So to sum up, no point keep, I don't want to keep repeating. So to sum up, I would say that my concluding thoughts, if I can call them, otherwise this topic one can go on and on and on. Being gender sensitive would essentially mean being open, being attentive, being responsive to all genders. These are the important attributes of a gender sensitive judiciary. We as judiciary must be gender sensitive, and gender justice and equalities, these are ideas which are still evolving, that's why you have judgments from Supreme Court from time to time. We haven't really evolved as a society so far, this is an ever expanding gender sensitiveness is an ever expanding issue, both in law as well as in society. So it is important that we have an open mind. We should be open-minded. We should listen to the views of however personal dislike one may have, but we should have the patience. We should listen to the views and perspectives of all gender, LGBT, and think them through. Think them through from their, get into their mindset and think them through. Whether you agree or not is completely a different issue, but we should have the sensitiveness of thinking it through from their mindset. So disagreement is a separate matter altogether. Now, as I'll sum up, in fact, with Voltaire, the great French philosopher. In fact, he was the earliest proponents of freedom of speech and also of separation of church from state. So Voltaire said, "I disapprove of what you say, but I will defend to death your right to say it." So such is the outlook we should have towards other gender. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Lordship, for enlightening us on this aspect. On behalf of Chandigarh Judicial Academy and all the learned attendees, I thank your Lordship for taking out his valuable time and enlightening us on the various constitutional aspects with regard to the gender sensitization, and also taking us to the mythological background, and also, of course, sharing his own personal appearance with regard to his sister, who I just came to know from our director, sir, was one of the first officers who was inducted with Indian Air Force. And having from an army background, I really feel proud of the fact. But then there is a connected question with regard to the induction of women in the army or in the defense services, especially with the recent judgment in Babita Punya case, that now, as we all know, that where army women now have been inducted or have been granted the permanent commission. And now we also know that
army took longer because, as I said, army challenged it in Supreme Court, but yes, Air Force implemented the High Court judgment right away. So it happened because my sister was in Air Force, so it happened much earlier. So army has been in news for much longer thereafter, because Supreme Court also took 4 or 5 years, heavy pendency of cases, etc.
But Lordship, I had this question in my mind that now if now they have been given the permanent commission, I now had a discussion with my father also, who was a retired army officer, and a permanent commission means that now they are going to command the units. So as far my understanding is concerned.
Exactly. Now everything opens up. So as I said, now the men folk sitting there should have that kind of sensitivity that they are equally entitled to. Just because they're female officers, that doesn't disentitle them to hold those posts. Why not? They must.
In fact,
that's exactly my point. That's you're not doing it for providing protection of job. You're doing it for making them feel empowered. But nature has made them so empowered. Why can't we accept it that they are equally empowered?
Yes, Your Lordship, that's very right. But then again, a very minute doubt that I have in my mind is that how about the cases when such women officers are to be sent in the border? On the border, they'll have to be, they'll have to deal with all this.
Again, you think men folk are fighting at border with bare hands or something? It requires some physical prowess. They are using the same machines which a female officer is equally equipped to use. It's the press of a button.
Yes, I believe that should answer my question.
We all live in electronic age. You do not need to have good, it's computerized everything. Even taking an aim on the target is no more. I think that is also computerized. You have laser beams. Just look at it and shoot it. Just press the button.
Yes. So I think that really answers my question and my takeaway from the entire session of Your Lordship. And the one quote that he had, used is that nature gave too much power to women, but man gave none. So with this thought, please.
See, this particular session, a biopsy or an open heart surgery of the constitutional provisions correlating with the gender sensitization has been a meaningful session as such. You know, a teacher always lives in the reflected glory of his students. And one feels so proud of it. I am so blessed with such harvest of students who have done so well in life. You are one of them. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the kind words. We always look forward to your blessings, continuous blessings. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Lordship, again.
I can't see you. As I said, for me, it was more like a monologue. It must have been boring for you also, not being able to participate, not being able to really see in person. But yes, we look forward to better times when we will all meet. And
certainly.
I must put a parting note that I have a special affiliation with judiciary. As Dr. Balram Gupta sir introduced me in the beginning, being a second generation judge, my father was in Punjab judiciary. In fact, when I finished my law, he was so keen that I should have competed for the judicial civil services. And to be honest, this is all on the lighter side. I didn't know I'll come back and be a judge here. So I just ran away. Half my reason, maybe major reason, was that if I stay, he would have keep him, pushing me to take this examination. I didn't want to join judiciary. And I just ran away to Supreme Court. I said, I'm going to practice there, Supreme Court. If I make it, I make it. Otherwise, I'll do something else. So it was just a decision in rebel that I went to Delhi. And look at me, I'm back again with all of you. Never knew that this is what in store for me. But anyway, it happened.
Thank you
everybody for attending these two sessions of webinar that we had. And as we all know that these sessions will now be available to our YouTube channel, and we shall also be sending you the videos on your SMS. So you please free to watch the webinars as in when you feel so. Till we meet again with another beautiful topic, with another webinar session. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, each one of you. Grateful.